Welcome everyone to Jesus Image Church. How is everyone doing? Welcome to our online family. Tonight is going to be an incredible night. I have a scripture to read out of Psalms. Psalms 68, 3 and 4 says, "But let the godly rejoice and let them be glad in God's presence. Let them be filled with joy. Sing praises to God, to his name. Sing loud praises to him who rides on the clouds. For his name is Lord. Rejoice in his presence." Can we just stretch our hands and we say, we thank you, Jesus. Your name is Lord and we welcome you. We invite you to reign in this room, Jesus. We invite you to reign in our lives. We welcome you, Jesus. Let's just lift a shout really quick. Let's lift a shout and we say, welcome, Jesus. Welcome, Jesus. Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Can we lift up another great shout to him tonight? Okay, this shout is for the reigning King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Come on, let's really shout to him. Oh, we worship you tonight, Lord. We love you, Lord. That's it, church. risen King, seated in majesty. You are the risen King. Death could not hold you down. Oh no, you are the risen King, seated in majesty. You are the risen King. Sing hallelujah. You have won the victory. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me. Death could not hold you. You are the risen King, and you're seated in majesty. You are the risen King. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Worship the name of Jesus. Oh, worship the name of Jesus. Let's just sing a new song to the Lord. We'll fill this room with a song. Worthy, 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 worthy.
it's been forever in the pleasure I found looking in your eyes. Give me Jesus, give me Jesus, you can have all this world.
Give me the God of Scripture. No more idols or lesser loves. No substitute will ever do. There's nothing more I'll ever pursue.
Take this world and give me it. I have decided. This rise,
the same. The lonely find it has the power to create a bond, and that's the chains fall on the ground. Oh, we're pulling out to cleanse our soul. Oh,
really quick story. I don't usually do this, but I was talking to our church about the blood of Jesus and how when you apply the blood of Jesus to your life, it covers everything. Did you know that? Okay, so a little while ago, a few months ago, I had gotten this car, and I was excited about the car. It was awesome. I went one day and I went and put a lot of money into the car. And the very next day, one of my spiritual sons wrecked my car. And I was not happy about that. But I was driving another vehicle in front of him. And so I got to see it happen in the rearview mirror. And the first thing I thought was, I hope he's okay. You know, I'm thinking, oh my goodness, this joker just wrecked my car. And I just spent a lot of money yesterday. And so I got out of the car. I saw that he was okay. I saw that the other person was okay. And he comes up to me and he's kind of frantic, rightfully so. No, I'm just kidding. And he was like, I am so sorry, I'm so sorry. And I'm like, it's okay. And he just keeps saying, I'm so sorry. I know you just did this. I know you just, and I said, it's okay. It's okay. That's why we have insurance. And I looked at the other driver. That person was okay. And it seemed like they weren't going to freak out on us. So that's always a good sign. And he's still saying to me, I'm so sorry. And I looked at him and I said, I almost said his name just now, but I don't want to embarrass him. I said, am I freaking out right now? And he said, no. I said, then just take my lead. And I think sometimes we're knocked off balance by things that happen, and God's not freaking out about anything. There is not a single thing that could shake our God. But there was a reason that I wasn't shaken. Number one, God provides everything. Number two, I had full coverage. So I knew from bumper to bumper, whatever it was, my insurance was going to cover it. That's why you have it. So is the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus is perfect, and there's not a single issue that the blood of Jesus cannot cover. There's not a... There's not a single sickness that the blood of Jesus can't erase. Hey, there's not a single struggle that the blood of Jesus can't destroy. It's perfect. It's perfect. It's perfect.
It's perfect. It's perfect. It's perfect. It's perfect.
So we sing all the blood. Come on.
Oh!
one who paid my debt and raised this life apart from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and oh, praise the one who paid my debt and
raised his life up from the dead.
Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised his life
up from the dead.
Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised his life. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt.
Raise his life up from the dead.
Thank you for the blood, Lord. Thank you for your blood. Oh, it was more than enough, more than enough. Your blood, your blood, your blood. Jesus paid it all to him. Sin had left crimson stain. He was. Oh, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He was. It was. Jesus paid it all.
All to him I owe. Sin had left the crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Sin had left. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Say it again. You are Alpha.
You are Alpha. We give you all.
part of our lives. You are worthy, Jesus. We call you faithful one, beautiful one, the one who was and is to come. Jesus, you are faithful. I just kept hearing down there, the faithful one. Through every inconsistency of our life, he has been faithful. Through every doubt, every thought of anxiety, whatever it may be, he has been the faithful one, our faithful bridegroom. We love you, Jesus. Father, we give you tonight. We give you our lives. We give you everything, Jesus. We pray, continually speak to us tonight. I pray we leave more in love with you than when we walk through those doors. It is unto you. It is for you. It is by you. We love you, Jesus. We worship you in your beautiful, precious name. Beautiful, precious name. Come on, let's seal it with praise. Jesus, we thank you. Jesus, we thank you. Jesus, we thank you. Thank you, Mighty King. Thank you, Mighty King. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's give it up for our worship team and our choir. Thank you, Father. Amen. You guys can be seated in the presence of Jesus. Tonight's going to be an amazing night. It already has been. I mean, you know, everything we do it unto him. Not just in here, but our lives lived. Everything we do it unto Jesus. We're going to play a video real quick of Jesus 21. So if you guys want to all keep our eyes on the screens, you guys can play that video.
The night Jesus died on the cross and descended into the underworld, and the King of Glory shall come in. Who is this King of Glory?
Ye gates, ye everlasting doors, and the King of Glory shall come in. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord of Hosts, he is the King of Glory. Jesus, you have conquered death. The grave has been plundered. You are the King of Glory.
I'm excited for Jesus 21. My life has been forever changed by many of these Jesus encounters that we've had. I remember Jesus 16, I think it was. I remember I used to work back home in Salinas, California, and I would record the Jesus 16, Jesus 15, and then I would get home late after serving tables all night. It'd be like 11:30, 12 o'clock at night, and I would watch him on replay. And I remember just weeping in my living room watching it, thinking one day I hope I could just attend. One day I hope I could just go. And man, what an honor that we have it right in our backyard, right here in Orlando. We're believing God that Orlando will be saved in Jesus' name. Come on. We believe it. Salvation, signs, wonders, miracles, and more importantly, people falling in love with Jesus. We believe that here. A bunch of Jesus lovers. Come on, ascending right here in Orlando, Florida. So if you guys have not signed up, you guys have not gotten your guys' ticket, all the information is right there on the screens for you guys. You guys ready to give tonight? Come on. You guys ready to give tonight? Yes. Amen. It is worship unto Jesus. We don't have segments on a Sunday night where it's offering and it's break and then, you know, announcements. It's all worship. Like I said earlier, everything we do it unto him. And so if you guys want to open up the Holy Scriptures to Malachi chapter 3. This is obviously a familiar chapter when it comes to tithes and offerings. But what I do want to point out in this is that this is specifically spoken to priests.
the sons of Levi. How many know we're all priests in here unto him? Come on, in the kingdom, we could be sons and daughters. We could, amen? So these are Levitical priests, and Jesus is pinpointing something in their lives. And if you guys want to start with chapter 7, it says, ever since the days of your ancestors, you have scorned the decrees and failed to obey them. Now return to me, and I'll return to you, says the Lord of heavens. But you ask, how can we return to you when we have never gone away? Should people cheat God? Yet you have cheated me. But they ask, what do you mean? When did we ever cheat you? He says, you have cheated me of the tithes and the offerings due to me. Now, if you guys want to go over to Luke chapter 11, we could start in verse 42. It says, now this is Jesus addressing another group of people. And these are Pharisees and Sadducees. And in 42, it says, what sorrow awaits you, Pharisees, for you are careful to tithe even the tiniest income from your herb and your gardens. But you ignore justice and the love of God. You should tithe, yes, but do not neglect the more important things. What's amazing is you have a group of Pharisees over here, and then you have a group of Levites and priests and worshipers over here. And in one setting, the Lord is saying, you have excelled in all other areas, but you left this one thing, tithe and offerings. Then you have another group of people over here, which are Pharisees and Sadducees. And he says, you're excelling in the tithe and the offering, but you're forgetting about these other things. It's amazing that the Lord knows how to pinpoint the very parts of our heart that we are withholding from God. That we can excel in so many different areas and things within the body of Christ, and it's beautiful. But how many guys know for him to be Lord, he needs to be Lord over all? And part of that is with our tithes and with our offerings. Come on, he owns everything. Come on, he owns our workplace, he owns our family, he owns our finances. And so it's amazing that Jesus beautifully knows how to go right to the heart and to that point that we may be holding back from him. So I pray we open up our hearts today and we allow the Holy Spirit to highlight if it may be us in this area. If we are excelling in other things, but we are holding on tightly in this area of finances. So let me pray over you guys. Jesus, we thank you. God, we thank you that you're a good father. A father that loves us and corrects us and helps us and leads us. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. God, I pray a blessing over each and every individual in this house and everybody watching online. God, we thank you, Father, that we can give directly into your hands tonight. God, we thank you that every good and perfect gift comes down from you, the Father of lights. We love you, Jesus. It's an honor to give directly into your hands. Into your hands. We thank you, mighty King. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. If you guys need an envelope, we have ushers throughout the building. They're going to bring the buckets up. If you guys want a text to give, we have our text to give right here on the screens. And for those of you guys watching online, there's a number right there on the bottom of your guys' screen that you guys could text as well. We're going to be back shortly. You guys could come up and rush the buckets.
In the crashing, in the pressing, you were making a new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you were breaking new ground. So I yield to you and to your careful hand.
Come on, every voice, every voice.
Make me a vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. God, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Make me
right. Wasn't this morning amazing? Come on. Jesus touched many of us, me included. So obviously you guys know we have family here tonight. Mr. Ben Fitzgerald. We always do it twice here. It's amazing. If we just say the name, it's boom. He truly is family, and he's a man of integrity. What he preached this morning, I've had a few times been able to be with him, and he truly lives what he preaches and preaches what he lives. And he's authentic through and through. And we just want to say we have been blessed by you, Ben. We have been blessed in the school by you. We've been blessed year after year with your voice in this environment. And so we are so thankful to hear Jesus through you tonight. So let's give it up as family would for Miss Ben Fitzgerald.
I love you. Come on. Come on. Praise you, great King. Praise you, great King. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Lord God Almighty, you're a wonderful Jesus. You're a wonderful God. Thank you, Father God, in the public place, the private place, in our beds, Lord, at the kitchen, even while we're doing such things as dishes, we will tell you you're wonderful. We'll glorify your holy name. We give you all the praise and all the thanks for what you've done today and what you're going to do tonight. In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. I want you to stay standing for one moment. I'd like to pray for Benny Koulianos. I talked to Jess about this. She was okay with me sharing this. It's nothing major, but you know when kids, and Benny is certainly an adventurous kid, they get into games, football, things like that. And so I just want to just take 30 seconds to pray for his healing. His shoulder, he hurt it today. So let's pray for him, that the other kid's okay as well. but let's pray for his shoulder right now, just for healing and just courage and strength in him and just great joy and rest over their family. So Father, we thank you for these amazing leaders you've given to this house and given to the nations of the world, for Michael and Jessica, for all that they have pioneered for this team here. And we pray for their beautiful son, Benny, today. We release and we loose healing over his shoulder. We pray that he tonight in his bed would just feel these movements of Jesus going across his shoulder and he wake up completely healed. We thank you for him and we thank you for kids who have adventure. And we praise you for his amazing destiny and future as a preacher of the gospel, man of God, and a man of great wild joy and fire. And we bless the Koulianos family. Guys, sometimes we need to pray for our pastors. Sometimes we need to bless our leaders more because little things like this happen, you know, and they carry such a burden, such a load, but it's actually all worth it for the King. But we pray for Michael and Jessica. God, bring great blessing over them. Great, great blessing. And pray for Michael too as he's right now preaching in Upper Room. I know that people will be giving their lives to you and devoting their heart to you, Jesus. We bless them over there as well in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen? Amen. Amen. You might be seated. Well, it's always a joy to be back here. It's one of the hardest places for me to preach because I realize about 5 seconds before I preach that I've lost my voice in worship. Every time I come here, I shout and yell and do things I don't do. I do them in the car, shower, you know. But when I come here, it's just such a... My goodness, you guys, do you realize what is happening here is really feeding the nations? You're in the midst of something that's so beautiful. There's such an innocence of worship. And people are, in this room are pioneering what that means to really be devoted to God. And so it's a blessing for me and my team in Awakening in Germany. We often stay up late and watch the messages. I've got some of my team here. I know Nathan... He watches, his secret life is Jesus image worship. He doesn't like my songs. So he loves it and he loves being here and we're really thrilled at just what the Lord is doing. Every time I visit, it's like family to me. It's not like visiting a church. It's visiting my very dear friends. And that's why I said to you, you know, I know the inner world and an intimate way of Michael and Jessica, and you guys have leaders that really love the King. And a lot of leaders are like that around the world. I'm certainly not degrading one to exalt another, but what I'm saying is that these guys are the real deal, henceforth the reason why we can just come and cry out to God here and be so filled. I don't know about you, but every time I come to a church service here, I walk away so filled with God. But tonight I want to talk about the other side of the coin of being filled with the Lord. And that is that this glorious Jesus, this glorious gospel, and all that he's done for us and in us, and how we receive from him, we drink from his love here, we have that those cries of joy and adoration exploding in our heart, all of that doesn't just belong to me. It belongs to those he loves. And in Christianity, there's sort of this sacred divide that I really don't believe God created. Of course, Scripture says, come out and be separate from among the world and the ways of the world. But the Scripture is very, very clear that God gave Jesus to the world, not just to the church. And he came to seek and to save that which is lost. And I love worship. It's my heartbeat. I don't know how you could be a Christian and not love to adore the Lord because of all he's done for you. But I have noticed in myself over the years, traveling around the world, somehow I can become so familiar around this space, in these kind of rooms, and my heart can be subtly inoculated to the adoration, the hunger. And literally the Bible, where it says that in Luke, it says he came to seek. That word in the Hebrew, the definition is crave the lost. He came to crave you and he came to crave me. But I can get too familiar here sometimes. How many of you understand this is not the definition of Christian success? When you get up here, Jesus will not cheer for you. He'll celebrate that you're in your calling. But this does, I can tell you guys, I've stood in front of thousands of people all across Europe, week after week, big stadiums, all this stuff, and the times, they're glorious. It's so amazing to be there. But also, I've walked across the road from stadiums where I'm the supposed leader, you know, where I should be the big shot in the environment, which, to be quite honest with you, honor is correct, but pride and arrogance is quickly leaving the family of God, where people think that if they're a preacher, a pastor, a leader, or if they're a worship leader, that there's something better about them than another Christian. There's not. It's the same blood. And so the Lord would regularly challenge me because I'd get so engrossed in these stadiums. And I remember one time being in the city of Prague. And I was so busy inside, you know. And I couldn't wait for all these people to come. And I was doing the will of God. And God celebrates that we're in his will. Don't get me wrong. He loves the pulpit. He loves the message. This is no less of worship because it's the word. This is all worship. It's all unto him. It's all unto his eternal glory. But I remember one time, and I was just so busy, and I was walking across the stadium, and I had a few people with me, you know, looking after me. I love that we have security because there is weird people, to be quite honest, especially in charismatic churches. So it's good to have people. But I'm not a professional. To be quite honest with you, I sense the Spirit of God in the house of God, in the church globally where I travel. I sense him ripping off this professional Christianity. I sense him just destroying it and bringing people back to this kind of innocent love, innocent fire, innocent like joy where you jump even if you're not a jumper. I'm not a jumper. When I jump and do a twirl, it says David danced before the Lord was pleased. When I do a twirl, it looks like Kung Fu Panda. You know, I think the Lord probably looks and goes, I admire your boldness, you know. But lately, the Lord's been showing me like, Ben, you're a minister, yes, but you're a son. You're redeemed by the same blood as a homeless woman. I'll never forget being in Prague because this really marked me, this particular experience. I was there and I walked out of the stadium that we had hired, and this ticket sales, it's just gone nuts. It was the biggest event in 40 years in the nation. And that's a whole generation had never seen God move this way. And the Lord had me the privilege, which is actually a very low, very humble, very dependent place, of trying to lead that. But as I was heading to the hotel late at night, there was a small bar. I walked across the road. The hotel was adjacent, just up the street, to the stadium. I walked across the road, and there's these guys drinking. I mean, and, you know, it's late at night. They're not casually drinking. And I walked past the bar, and the Spirit of God gripped me. You see, I realized that I can say, God, I give you my all, but He only moves me according to the paths that I've created. Like a chessboard. But God doesn't have you on a chessboard. He has you in the wind. So I walked, and the Spirit of God, and it's 11 o'clock or so at night or something, and the Spirit of God says, Ben, go to those people now. And I've got my team, you know, looking after me and all those things, and that's all, again, that's not wrong, it's good. It's only wrong, though, when it takes me away from this pure, raw love for people. And I said, okay, God, but I was wrecked. I mean, you have to understand, when you run a stadium event, it's not easy. You're tired. You're up at 6, you're in bed at 1, and it just rolls into the it's like a week worth of that, you know? And so I stopped and I said, hey, excuse me, guys. I think 2 of them out of the 6 or 7 spoke English. I said, excuse me, guys, I'm so sorry to bother you while you're here. And they're drinking. I mean, they're getting into it. And I said, I just really felt to stop you and tell you that Jesus Christ is real and that He loves you. And I'm talking just to one guy particularly, but I said, Jesus is real and He loves you. And the guy had a drink. And he goes like this. He looked at me. He looked at his friends and he goes, puts his drink down hard like that. And he goes, how do you know what we're talking about? And I said, what do you mean? I said, I don't know what you're talking about. They were speaking in the Czech language. I had no clue. They said, we were discussing for the last 30 minutes, is there a God or is there not? Okay? And that's amazing, but that shouldn't surprise us. That's normal for my Messiah. My Messiah would have walked out of the stadium having Peter and James and John with him, and my Messiah would have stopped and told him 10 times what I said. That's normal for the King. And I want to tell you something. If you're a true worshiper, if you really love Him, if you really are Mary, you'll be at His feet, but you won't just stay there, you'll stay where His feet go. You'll follow them. You remember that this cross was for you, that all of your sin, even if you grew up in church, and that's the problem, is we have so many who grew up in church, so they've known an affiliation with God. But you know, the Bible says that we were retrobate against God in our mind by wicked works. You can be nice on the outside and then gossip to your husband about how much you hate that guy. Wickedness, sin. It's not just the major sins, unforgiveness, pride, Christian performance. Oh, I'm better than that person. I worship better. This is the stuff He hung on the cross for. And when the Lord begins to sanctify and wash you, because He hung up there as a pure lamb, sinless, innocent, the sinless, guiltless man, Jesus Christ, taking all our guilt and shame on Himself. And when you begin to remember that, you realize you can't keep this to yourself. But I want to tell you some sobering things and read some scripture to you tonight. And these sobering things are not to at all condemn any person in this room. I'm not preaching this from some high place. I will come to the same street corner with you. I'm talking from a place of vulnerability where the Lord strips off me the comfortability, the things that I get used to, in this thing we call Christendom, where we love God, but we love Him in accordance with the way we move the chess piece. And He wants to breathe wind on you because there's a harvest coming. He wants to breathe wind on you because He loves your unsafe sister the same way He loves you. Do you know this year, in 2 weeks or whatever it is, a week and a half, this year is the 400th year of Thanksgiving. It started in 1621, and the pilgrims thanked God for the harvest. And I believe that is a prophetic sign for us in this time, that this 400th anniversary is a time for us to prepare and to give thanks, not only to God for our salvation, but for those that He's willing to save through us. Because our God is mighty to save. I forgot to finish the Czech story. By the way, I was able to pray for them, preach to them. He preached through me, he interpreted everything I said, and then they came to the stadium. Gave him free tickets. How good is that? How good is God? So the Lord is so good. But this is normal Christianity. This is not abstract. But I want to share these statistics with you. And then I want to go deep into Scripture because this preaches better than anyone. There's some sad statistics right now in the Western church, like this one. The Barna Institute have found that 96% of Christians don't lead a single soul to Jesus. They may love somebody. They may have coffee with someone. They may be kind to somebody. But that residence of hell and darkness that grips a person's life, most people in the Western church are not moved by that. If I'm honest with myself, how often do I truly think of eternity? How often do I perceive the spirit realm? I can perceive it in deep moments of worship. And that's beautiful, and the Lord puts no guilt on His presence. Don't hear what I'm not saying that this is wrong. I'm saying that there's so much more that God wants to give to us. But 96% of Christians don't lead anyone to Jesus. Another study came out that said that it takes 85 believers to save one person. So per 85 believers, one person meets God. They found out through the Barna Institute that the ones who do lead people to Jesus are usually saved for less than 1 year. And why? Why would they be so fervent? Why would they care so much about somebody who's a stranger? Because the Messiah has cared for them. Because they've felt the touch of His grace that has washed their heart. They've felt what it feels like to be loved for nothing. And I think that sometimes, it's not like anyone chooses this, but sometimes we get so used to being with each other that we forget that Messiah, King Jesus, is not always in church. He's out there somewhere. He's out there seeking and saving someone. I'll never forget the story of Aaron Adam Jedson. You know who that is? He was one of the first missionaries. He wrote this book called To the Golden Shores, Missionary to India. Amazing man of God, but he wasn't always an amazing man of God. At the age of 12, Aaron Adam Judson could read Revelation and preach it. He could preach it so well, he could remember the whole book of Revelation back to front. His father said, "This man surely will be a revelatory teacher, pastor. He's going to be a minister that changes the world." Aaron Adam Judson had this genius IQ, but he loved the Scriptures. He loved God. And then he went to Yale. And he met this man who was also a genius, and they put them in the same, you know how you move in university, they put them in the same place, living in the same place. And Aaron Adam Judson, this godly man who loved God, began to think and use his mind to conceive other ideas, not outside of God at this time, but just like the universe and stars, and it's all amazing. And it is all amazing. And God created it to be discovered. But after a little while, this man named Jacob Ames, who lived with him, who was also so intelligent, begin to convince him into kind of like a thing of God is not relational. He's not a Jesus. He's just a deity out there. He's not really here. He doesn't talk to you. The Scriptures are man-made. And because he was so intelligent, he argued this genius, Aaron Adam, out of this belief in Christ. And Aaron Adam started to be, he wanted to be a teacher and just teach people, but he was teaching by this point the worldly stuff. He stopped teaching the Bible. This guy who could preach, can you imagine a 12-year-old kid up here revealing the book of Revelation? A sovereign call and grace of God on him. But he wanted success. He wanted to be known. He wanted to teach people. He wanted to use his intelligence, the brain that God gave him. But pretty soon the brain God gave him convinced himself that he didn't need the God who made it. And he did it by this man who moved in with him in the house in Yale. Well, many years later, Aaron Adam Jedson was on his horse traveling. He used to teach all over the world, all over America. And while he was on his horse, he got very tired and he came very late into this village and he couldn't find a place to stay. There was only one place, a little bit like Jesus with Mary and Joseph. There was only one spot in the inn. But he went to this hotel and they said, "Sir, I'm so sorry, we're full." And he said, "I've rode on horseback all day. I have nowhere to go. Please just let me stay somewhere." They said, "Well, we have one room." This is many years later. He said, "We have one room, but this room right now is occupied by a very sick man who screams. He's so physically sick, he's dying. He's next door to you in that room. If you really want it, you can take it, but we don't suggest you do." But Aaron Adam, he was so tired, he said, "It's fine. I need to put my head down somewhere." So he gets into that room and he hears this person, another guy in the other room next door, screaming and cursing at God. Screaming, "Oh!" His body, "Ah!" Like he's crying out to God like that. He's dying. It affected Aaron Adam a little bit. But he said at 2:30, the man went quiet and Aaron Adam fell into a deep sleep and he woke up peacefully. He went down in the very morning to pay, you know, to fix the bill. That's what you did back then. And when he went down to check out of the hotel, the gentleman said, "How did you sleep, sir?" And he said, "Actually, it wasn't bad at all." He said, "The man just went to bed, I guess, at 2:30 in the morning, and he stopped yelling." And he said, "So I slept well." And he said, "Oh, no, sir." He said, "The man didn't go to sleep. The man died." He said, "At 2:30 in the morning, that man breathed his last breath." And he said, "Oh, I'm so sorry. That's a shame. That's not good." And just before he's about to leave, he turned around and said, "By the way, what was the man's name?" And he said, "Well, sir, it's pretty funny. He was a young man, highly intelligent. His name was Jacob Ames. It was his housemate from Yale." God put him in the same hotel, in the same room, the same space with a person that convinced him there is no God. He said he got on his horseback. And as he got on his horseback, all of a sudden he said he couldn't see the road in front of him because the tears were flowing down his eyes so deeply that he was so gripped, and every step of the horse that it was moving down the road, he heard two words: death, hell, death, hell, death, hell. And he cried out to God, "Oh God, I'm sorry. Please save me. Please forgive me for being too intelligent, too preoccupied, for knowing better than you." The Lord Jesus forgave Aaron Adam. He became a mighty preacher of the gospel. But when he moved to India, he did it because he said, "Jesus, you chose. It wasn't me dying in that room. You chose me. How could I withhold this treasure from anyone again? I was so, in my mind, so intelligent, so pushing you away, so doing other things, you know, distracting myself." And he said, "But now I will serve you, my King." And he moved to India as a mission with his family. And he didn't lead a single soul to Jesus for 7 years. But he preached every single day of those 7 years. Where is that conviction in the Western church now? Where is that zeal for people now? Do you know why Aaron Adam had that zeal? Because he realized that should have been him going to hell. He realized the guilt of the cross, all his sin, was actually his responsibility. He would have been the one who was given the eternal sentence of death. But he wasn't given that. He was given freedom and a brand new chance of life. He spent 7 years. It reminds me of a story of D.L. Moody. I shared it this morning. Now, please, none of you do this. Otherwise, you'll be in prison. But D.L. Moody, he was a preacher of the gospel in his early age. He saw this girl, young girl, maybe 12, 13, 15, something like that. She was by a bakery begging. And he felt when he walked by her, he felt, "I can feel God wants to save this girl." And so he went near to the girl. And he said, "Hey, would you come to church tomorrow? Come to my church. It's an amazing place. Jesus is there. Come to church. God really wants to speak to you." She said, "Oh, thank you, sir." She didn't give him any guarantee. But the next day, he noticed when he was at church, she's not here. See, sometimes, guys, I drive to church, and as I'm driving, I've had moments where the Lord has overtaken me that I've nearly crashed because I'm overwhelmingly weeping as the Spirit comes on me. Not my strength, Not your strength, not my love. I don't have the capacity to love the world, neither do you. But there's someone inside you who does. And I've had the Lord overtake me as I see all these cars going down the other highway. And Jesus will say to me, Ben, most of these people are headed to hell. What are you going to do? And I'll just bore my eyes out. And I'll sit in the front row or some church I preach at, and I'll have this intense moment in worship where I can feel His presence. And then I think about two or three people I know. And I'm like, why don't I want them here? What's stopping me from loving them? They should be experiencing this with me. But most of the Western church doesn't see things that way. We would all applaud the context of evangelism. If I said to you, who wants to save souls? We'll all stand up because our heart cry is to live this way. But the enemy fights us. See, in Christianity, we don't stop tonight at the bar. We don't drive home and go, you know what I'll do? I'll go and get some drugs in the worst neighborhood in town. We don't do that. But we still have one Christian vice that is acceptable and sometimes even celebrated in church, and it's called busyness. We busy ourselves away from the presence of God, and we busy ourselves away from yielding to the wind. But it's only in yielding to the wind that you meet people for Him. What about your unsaved best friend? What about your unsaved brother, sister, who knew God once like Aaron Edom did? How do you know that their future isn't to be an apostle to a whole nation, but right now they're deeply entrenched in sin? See, Aaron Edom had people praying for him, I'm sure, contending for his life. And God wants us to be the same, not because of guilt, but because He's inviting us to love those He loves. If you're a true worshiper, don't you want the feet of others to give Him worship also? Don't you want the world to worship Him? Let's look at some scripture here. I want you to turn your Bible open if you can. Let's start here at Acts chapter 20, verse 24. This is Paul speaking. Paul understanding that he was such an offender of God because he thought he knew better than Jesus. But then when he met Jesus, the brushstroke of God's mercy, it touched him so deeply that he was forever changed. And this is what he said. Acts chapter 20, verse 24, he said, "But none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I receive from the Lord Jesus." And here is the ministry, ready? "To testify to the gospel of His grace, to testify about who He is." See, we weren't born just to love on Him. We were born to love on others. Some part of your heart can never truly know God, can never be so intimate with the Lord unless the love you have is given away. Jesus came and said, "I want to show you what the Father's like. Here I am. In the Father, He's in me, the Spirit's in me. Here I am." Philip said, "Show us the Father." He's like, "You're looking at the Father, He's in me." But what did He show us? He didn't show us just camping around a house church. He didn't show us just going to a prayer meeting. He showed us His pursuit. He showed us His craving for human souls. His craving for you, His craving for us. Paul said, "While we were yet dead in trespasses and sins against Him, He made us alive together with God, for by grace you've been saved." Can you believe that this man, perfect Jesus, flowing white robes, never sinned against God, perfect DNA, everything inside Him is God, climbed up on a cross, mostly naked, almost fully naked, ribbons of His flesh hanging out, and He did that for you? Can you fathom that love? The wonder and depth of who He is, that He would jump up on here and He'd look at your future and say, "Drive those nails into me because I know the freedom I'll give to her." It would be the greatest sin against heaven to have that kind of freedom in our heart and never give it away. In the 1700s, one of the world's most expensive violins, it was so good. They make these ones called Stradivarius. They're unbelievable. And there was this incredible violinist. I mean, when he played, it was like here, you know? When he played, there was sound. There was a God-given grace to this man. And this wealthy, wealthy individual wanted to buy it just because of its worth. And he bought it. He bought it for millions. And this man who knew about this violin, who played it, who was so gifted and so filled with life and passion for this violin, he actually said to the man, he said, please, please let me play it one more time. Before you take it away, the man was going to consign it to silence. He wanted it purely for its monetary value, its rarity. But he was going to consign it to silence. This man said, please, just let me play it one more time. This wealthy millionaire watched as this young man took the violin and just began to play these heavenly notes and begin to love this sound that came out of this violin. And the man was so moved that at the end of this man playing only for a few minutes, he said, I am so sorry, I've made a big mistake. He said, please take this sound to the world. The violin we play is Jesus. The sound we have is Jesus. We can't keep it in the church. We can't keep it as a rare thing. Yes, we treasure the presence of God, but it's not just for you. It's for the world to hear. So Paul said, I count everything else to be nothing that I might finish this ministry, to tell everyone about Jesus, the guy you couldn't deal with, Paul. You need a gun, whip, and a chair to sit him down to try and get him to change. He wouldn't change. He understood what true love is. They put him in prison. He starts a worship set. He starts to adore the Silas, let's worship Jesus. Silas is like, okay. They sing. The Spirit of God trembles with power, shakes the very chains off. The first thing Paul never thought about was his own freedom. He was so dead. The first thing he did is he began to preach and say, don't worry, guards, we're still here. He preached to the whole prison. He didn't say, get me out of here. I deserve freedom. See, we can never, ever become entitled. You got to keep looking here. You got to keep looking here until you realize it was your sin. And you don't feel guilty. I don't feel one drop of guilt when I look at the cross. I'm just like, Jesus, how could you do this for me? And so when the Lord whispers in my ear, when you're running a stadium event, stop this person right here. I can't convenience myself out of that love. I can't make Jesus step over my convenience in order to save someone from hell. Because if I have the chance, and if you have the chance to redirect one human life away from darkness, you should. If you have the chance to play the beauty of Jesus and to play the sound of what he's done in your life, you should. Don't withhold it from the world. That's what I love about this house, is the anointing to bring a sound, the anointing to bring everybody to the feet of the Messiah. And Michael, what I'm preaching right now, he preaches every single week. But it's not just his job, it's ours together. If I offered you $1 billion, would you give me your salvation? If I offered you 100 Ferraris, would you give it to me? It's a treasure to you, isn't it? How then, in the world of Christendom, in this beauty and dance with the Lord, how did it happen that it takes 85 people? The 84 of them are just dancing with God, but there's one, the 85th one, decides that my salvation is worth so much, I've got to, somebody else must experience this. In the book of Leviticus, chapter 19, verse 33, it says this. When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born in the same way. Love them as you love, love them as yourself. And you ready for this? For you were foreigners in Egypt. What does that mean? You were sinful. You were in bondage. You remember when you were a slave? Love them as you love yourself. And he says, for I'm the Lord your God. All the way back before Jesus ever came, God made these two commissions to human beings. Adam opened his eyes. The first thing he saw was God. And God looked at him, I love you. No guilt, no shame. Can you imagine just walking like this with God? No feeling of insecurity, no fear of man, just perfect peace. And he's walking with the Lord like this, and he's talking to God. And the first person he saw was the Lord, Yahweh himself. Yeshua himself, the Holy Spirit. He knew God face to face. And God told him and Eve, said, hey, I just have two things to tell you. Please be fruitful and please multiply. Jesus arrives. And at the end of his life on earth, see, if I was going to die tomorrow, I would tell you the most important thing that I want you to remember me for and I want you to think about. I would tell you all that is in my heart in one statement, if I could. And Jesus is about to ascend in resurrection off the earth. And he tells these disciples this statement that reflects Genesis chapter 1, where in the beginning God said, be fruitful. See, Christians, we love fruit, don't we? Some of you love to eat it. I like it too. I like Chick-fil-A more. But we love fruit. We inspect fruit. Oh, what's the fruit of that ministry? What's going to be the fruit of this? How are our fruits? We have this kind of magnetism toward fruitfulness because that's the way God made it in the beginning. He said, be fruitful. But the second commission was to multiply. Jesus comes as God and says, church, now you're born of God. You have the fruits of the Spirit. And then he leaves this great, not great suggestion, great commission. And he says, now take this gospel to the ends of the earth and multiply. I have this fear in my heart at times and this conviction, like, God, I feel like as a Western church, we love to be fruitful. We want to see fruit. We want to see growth. We want to see you move. But do we love to multiply your children? Do we love the gospel? See, I don't want to stand in heaven alone. Do you? I could not bear the thought of my brother not being in heaven. But there was a time when I was so filled and possessed with my focus and busyness on ministry that the Lord had to wake me. I was so asleep, man, honestly. My brother was a worship leader. Much like, you know, on the guitar tonight, Aaron, my brother he's an acoustic guitarist, worship leader, and I was in Redding, California. I was being blessed. I was preaching all the time, and I was getting invited to churches all around the world, and it was blessed, and I enjoyed it. But then this thing happened inside me. My mother rang me, and she said, Ben, your brother is on speed. He's injecting speed into his arm, and he told me to my face, I renounce God. And I said, what? I said, no, Mom, you must be wrong. She's screaming on the phone. She says to me, he wants to renounce God. And I said, no, Mom, that's not Sam. That's not Sam. Are you sure? She said, no, he doesn't want anything to do with God. I got off the phone. I started crying. I was weeping. I said, Lord, no, not Sam. Not innocent Sam. Always at church. Always faithful. First one to worship. Not Sam. I prayed with such passion. The next day I prayed, Lord God, touch Sam, please, wherever he is. My mom said he was in the casino from 12 at night till 6 a.m. every night. God, touch him. Day 3, Lord, save Sam. Touch him, God. Please bring him back. Day 4, I'm on someone's pulpit again. By day 5, to be quite honest with you, I've forgotten. I had no concept that Satan had taken hold of my brother. My eternal thinking was gone out of the picture. I wasn't seeing what Jesus sees. My mom rings a month later. It's worse. It's gotten way worse. She goes, your brother is going downhill fast. I get off the phone. Oh God, please save him. And it was genuine in the moment. 2-3 days later, my prayer life had disappeared for him. While I got back to Australia after being there at Bethel, I was ordained as a pastor and I got back to Australia and something very, very profound happened to me and I want it to happen to you. I don't want it to happen to you because you need it to be a good Christian. I want it to happen to you because there's a part of the heart of Jesus that you can only truly minister to when you truly love who he loves. Seriously, do you know you give an account for your love and your kindness to a homeless man? Do you know that there's something special when you meet a minister who can preach their heart out and has all this anointing and growing and they have very big ministry that's growing all over the world and planning 50 campuses and then you see that same minister stopped at a drive-through and he's praying for someone. There's something so special about that. But sadly, many people grow out of that. They become so familiar with God. They become so familiar here. They enjoy God so much and they're trying to serve, but they forget that Jesus isn't there. Jesus isn't just in church. He's there, but he's in the world. What do you think Jesus is doing? If I could ask you this question, where do you think Jesus would be when this service ends tonight? Where is he? Where will Jesus be tomorrow? Will Jesus be next to you when you're sitting at your workplace and the person who's had migraines for 5 days, who always complains, whose husband left her, who's got a terrible life and she's narky and snappy and you're holy and you know that's gross the way she is, but is Jesus looking over your shoulder going, but I love her? But you're here and you're filled with light. He said, I'm the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. It cannot be put under a bushel. But see, even as a preacher, with a heart and passion for evangelism, I was losing this innocent flame. I was becoming too professional and the Lord had to wake me. So I get back to Australia and I see my brother and I was shocked, to be honest with you. I was shocked because he was so darkened. I could see this worship leading guy, just like Aaron, beautiful man, man of God. Now he had demons in him. I could see them in his eyes. I could see he's far from the Lord. But it wasn't enough to wake me yet until I walked past his room. In a trash can by his room, he had his Bible that he'd read for years and a journal. He'd written in this journal for 5 years or so and he chucked it in the trash. This is the thought that went through my mind. That's a shame. I'll pick that up in case he gets saved. Can you imagine the heart of the Lord hearing my thought? Son, what do you mean in case? Are you hoping that sovereignly you'll have no part in this and it'll just all be me? Does the Western church just look at God and go, God, we love you so much and 84 of us are just so in love and one of us goes and saves and that's your sovereign plan? I'm not saying this to Jesus' image. I'm saying this to each individual heart, including mine. I'm saying that there's a part of his love that honestly, I'll tell you what happened to me and then I'll tell you why it fulfilled me so much. I took the journal, I got it and took it into my bedroom with his Bible. I would never do this, but I felt I should open it. I opened that journal and guys, I have experienced the untainted love that Jesus has for human beings. I have felt it. It's extremely scary. It's the Son of Man came to seek and save the craving of God for a human. The history. Be like if you had a loved one who you've written letters to for 5 years, back and forth. They say, I love you, I miss you. You're the best uncle, you're the best sister, you're the best boyfriend. And then all of a sudden it's cut off. Well, Jesus doesn't just sit in heaven and just go, oh, well, it's cut off. It doesn't bother me. No, the Lord has feelings. The Lord can be moved. With compassion, he can be moved with grief. I opened that journal and I read one line, and I will not do it for the sake of your ears, what happened to me, but I read one line and it was like this, Dear Jesus, I love you so, so much. I thank you for all that you've done in me. I want to truly serve you. And as I read it, I literally started to shake like this and I'm like, and then something hit me like in the inside, like something exploded in me, and I was struck to the ground. For 45 minutes, I was shaking and crying and weeping underneath Romans 8, the groanings which cannot be expressed. I felt this no-filtered, unfiltered, unadulterated love that comes from the cross to a human. I felt it. But God only let me feel it for about 10 seconds. And that 10 seconds, 45 minutes, I was overtaken. I couldn't control myself. Imagine if I had felt it for 5 minutes, I'd be days gone. I couldn't walk. God only lets us feel sometimes bits and pieces of this because it would kill us. It would overwhelm us. But I felt the wonder of his love for my brother. And when I did, I was shaking and weeping. I've never cried like that over a human. And I saw how Satan had him. But I saw that God is mighty to save. And I could feel Jesus like, that's my boy. I could feel this zeal of God. Jeremy Riddle wrote a song years ago that, you know, his love is deep, his love is wide, his love is furious. It's furious at Satan, and it's furiously loving to you. It's furiously in love with your mom who doesn't believe. It was furiously in love with Aaron Adam Jedson who decided he's smarter than God. But it was still there, and God chased Aaron Adam. God chased you. And now God gripped me that he's going to chase Sam. And I got up off the floor. My mom was freaked out. I got up off the floor and I was like, God, what do I do? What do I do? And this prayer came out of me that I just made up. I don't know where it came from, but I think it just came from the Spirit that I'd had it before a few times, but I just started saying, I bind him to the cross of Calvary. Get him, Jesus. I bind him to the work of your blood. And I pray you'd send angels to construct circumstances where he cannot escape your goodness. God, bring Jesus to face with him. I used to pray prayers like this, make the world empty. Let all the stuff he puts up his nose not work. Let it make him feel empty. But it was different now. It wasn't prayers of desperation. It was prayers like Jesus is going to get him. And so I'd put a photo on my phone. I'd get a text, I'd close it and I'd see his face. And I'd go, I bind you to the cross, Sam. I bind you to the cross. I didn't care to argue with him anymore. I didn't care to preach his ears off. I didn't care about any of that because I felt Jesus, the overwhelming grace, this overwhelming love he has for individuals. And I can tell you when I was first saved, that's what I had. When I was first saved, everyone I knew had to hear about it. And it wasn't that people told me to do that. In fact, I was in a Baptist church and Christians would come to me and say, you're in your honeymoon period. The man who invented that statement has a lot to answer for because what he basically said is this, your fire is going to die. How can our love for people die? If our love for people dies, your nation dies. If my love for Germans dies, Germany goes away into hell. That's the facts. That's the reality. That's not guilt. That's just this. And this is sobering and yet at the same time, perfectly empowering. So I said, get him, Jesus, get him. I went back to Bethel and now my brother was like, daily I'd think about him, I'd worship God. I thank you, Father, he's gonna worship you. I went back to Australia 9 months later. I saw my brother in the house, terrible, looked terrible. And I was like, hey, Sam. And I'm just like, hey, you know, and inside I'm like, God's gonna get you. You are stuffed. And I tell you, guys, most people that get saved have a praying mother. Put your hand up if you had a praying mom. Yeah, see? Look how many people. I tell you right now, if you have a praying mother, she has a contract on your head with God. You may as well just surrender. And that's what I begin to feel. But it shouldn't be relegated just to mothers. Should it? Don't they do enough? Come on, man. It's for us all. Worship's not for worshipers. Worship isn't for Dom. She's amazing, but worship is for all. We all worship. Love, loving what he loves is not for evangelists. You're not gonna stand in front of heaven. It wasn't my calling. He'll say, yes, it was, because I called you to walk like me. Romans 8. He'll say, your calling was to love them like I love them. Wasn't that the great commission, great commandment? It's the last thing I told you because it's the first thing I want you to think of. But I got that love back. The Christian sin of busyness and professionalism was cut off me somehow. And I couldn't wait to see him. I'm like, hey, Sam. And he was ignoring me. You know, he didn't want to be near me because he could feel God was with me still and he was guilty a little. But I was praying every day and I'd pray, you know, quietly and stuff so he wouldn't hear me. But he'd be gone most of the day anyway, most of the night, doing drugs, whatever. And then one day I'm with my mom in my kitchen and my brother walks in like this, really cool like this. You know, he's like, hey, Ben, are you going to church Sunday? And I'm like this. I'm like, yeah. And he goes, I think I'll come with you. And I acted real cool. I'm like, if you want to, I mean, you know, if you want, sure. You know, I acted real cool. Like, and then he goes, yeah, I said, I'll drive you. No problem. And I ran, I literally took off running down the hall. I'm like this. I got on the same place where I found this journal. I got on the floor and I went, I started to worship Jesus because he came to seek and save. I begin to adore my King silently, you know, Brother Lawrence type stuff. I was silently adoring him. Then I walked back out to, we'll leave at 9, you know. But inside my heart was like this. I'm like, Satan, you're gone. Your kingdom is destroyed. Jesus is going to save him. We got to church Sunday and I had one prayer. Keep him away from weird Christians. That was my only prayer. The first woman that comes up to him, whoa, show, she's like this. And I'm looking, I'm like, get away, woman, get away from, it's his salvation on the line here. You need to get back up, please, please. And she's like, well, you're Ben's brother and all this silly stuff she was saying. And I was like, please, please get away. And she goes, I feel from the Lord. I need to get you a drum kit. And I'm looking at her, you better deliver that drum kit ASAP. You need to get that at the front door of the house on Monday morning, you know, because his salvation's on the line. And she brought it to him. He doesn't even play drums. He used to sit on the bed and look at it for a week. But on Friday night, of that next week, Friday night, my clever mother, we used to have a home group in our house. My clever mother said to Sam, because he was cracking, you couldn't see it though. Why would God say, treat the foreigner, the one who's in slavery, the one who's not part of the house of God, treat them like their family? Because even if they look so wickedly sinful, so even if there's such darkness in them, how do you know they're not one hug away? How do you know that? Listen, guys. It's not us, the church, and them, the world. The only difference is this. This world is perishing. The ways of it are perishing. It will be consumed with fire, Peter says. We're not just camping around the world. I want us to have better government. Don't misunderstand the statement. I want us to go and be in the political world, business world. We should be in the places where we can influence for Jesus. That's 100% true. But Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. So what did he come for? He didn't come and say, I'm going to take this mountain here. Like, I'm going to take this little, you know, area, plot of ground. He owns all of the earth, but he doesn't have the will of man. He gave it away, much to the Father's grief in the beginning. But Jesus came to repair the grief. He came to finish the covenant. He came so that we could all turn and become children of God. So it's not us, the Christians, and them, the world. The only difference between you and somebody who doesn't know Jesus is you got saved first. That's it. We were all against God. We were all doing what they do. We just measure it different now. So my mom said to my brother, Sam, we don't have a worship leader in home group Friday. Do you remember when you used to play songs? Clever, mums are clever. He goes, yeah, but I'm not a Christian. She goes, it doesn't matter. Just play a song. Do you remember these, Oh, the Blood of Jesus, songs like that? He goes, yeah, I can look it up, I can, yeah. And I was just sitting there, I'm like, you're gonna be looking it up, all right? You're gonna be playing it. God's gonna smash you, you know? And God's gonna UFC you on Friday. And Friday night, everyone's worshiping. You know, my brother's playing guitar and he's kind of going along with a couple of the other musicians there. But she asked him to kind of lead a song or something. And And I'm worshiping and I'm like this. I'm watching him. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Yeah, we thank you for the cross. Get him, God. Get him, God. You know. And my brother started playing on the guitar, "Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus." And he started singing it. And then you just hear this, boom. So he hits the ground. I didn't even expect it. He hit the ground. He fell like that over the guitar. And I hear him just go, and he starts weeping. And all of us like jumped on him, like, get him. You know, we got straight on. And we're like, get out, devil. Every demon of hell, everything Satan did, get out of his life right now. Jesus, make him a new creation. Oh, he got saved. But he didn't just get saved. He got up off that floor. He was down there for 2 hours. I was like a seagull on the chips. I was just more, more, more. He got up like this, beaming with light. He was so full of God. And I was like, Sam, you're saved. And he's like, I'm saved. You know, he was completely changed. Now, let me tell you something that happened. You ready? And so I was with him for a few days. Just tell me when I need to finish because someone's standing in the way of the clock. So, okay. Thank you, brother. Yeah, he's just ducking. Now you can go to the ground and worship and pray. And no, I'm just kidding. But my brother was so saved. And so for the first few days, like every Christian, newborn, you know what he does? He's just like, God this, God that, God shows me this. I had a dream. I saw Jesus in a dream. Now I'm getting jealous. I'm like, hang on, this wasn't part of the deal. I prayed for 9 months. You know, now you get, where's my dream with you, Jesus? But he was so saved. And I went away to preach. I said to my brother, I texted him, I'm flying back in. I'll be home in 2 weeks. Can you pick me up? I came back to the house. Back to the airport 2 weeks later. But sadly, I see my brother where you come out of the airport, the doors open, everything where the cars are. I see him and he gets out of the car. He has black bags under his eyes again. And I looked at him. It was like something in me. My heart stopped. I looked at him. I was like, oh, inside, I'm like, oh, no, God, you know? Because now I'd felt this wonderful love for him. And you can feel this for someone. God will give this to you. God will hand it to you if you'll take it. His presence is a treasure, right? It's to be jealously guarded. He'll give you more if you'll take it. He'll give you this love for people if you'll join him. So I walked towards him and I said, hey, Sam. And he goes, hey, Ben. And he hugged me and I'm like, okay. But his face was like, didn't look good. And I said, Sam. And we're driving back to the house from the airport. I said, Sam, what's going on? And he goes, what do you mean? I said, you don't look so good. Champion, what's happening? And he goes, oh, sorry, I haven't slept in 7 days. And I'm like, what? And he goes, yeah. He goes, I've been worshiping from 7 p.m. and I usually don't end until 7 a.m. And I was like, are you serious? And he goes, yeah. He goes, and then I go to the streets and I'm like, this guy has gone nuts. He's not only been saved, he's actually become a Christian. He's become a Christ one, a little Christ. My brother ended up meeting his wife and becoming a pastor, serving the Lord, man of God, worships all the time, all to the glory of this cross. All to the glory of my King, your King. Well, what about your family? What about your friends? He loves people with this craving, seek and save. And the last thing our great rabbi said was go into all the world, preach the good news of the gospel, disciple them, teaching them my ways, believing for them, fighting for them as I have fought for you. Guys, you have the most perfect violin. You have the sound of freedom. Don't let it be conscribed just into our own private lives. Let them hear the sound. Because my brother, who's now a man of God, as I've been talking, many of you are thinking of your own brothers or your own friends or people who don't know Jesus yet. My question is this. Do you want this love? Will you take it with you? Will you carry it? Will you say, yes, God, I'll carry this love for the lost? Because I truly believe in Orlando, God didn't send you here by accident. There's no mistakes here. There is a well of history here. Jess's father saw thousands saved, her grandfather as well, Michael also. Michael every Sunday is preaching the gospel. There's a demonstration that we are supposed to be preaching and proclaiming him. But there's others out there who are waiting for your feet. And God sent you to Orlando with a purpose. He sent you, whoever you are watching at home, to your community with a purpose. Let's make sure that we don't just go to Samaria and to the ends of the earth and forget hometown Jerusalem. Because this city belongs to God. And before I pray, I want to give you the gift of an assignment from heaven. Here's the assignment. Find one. Start with just one. And pray for them every single day. Get in their world. Be Jehovah sneaky with them. Have them over for dinner. Let them complain about how bad everything is, how Christians hurt them. Let them do all that stuff and sit there and eat Chick-fil-A with them and look them in the eyes and tell them, you need to do that. Look them in the eyes and tell them, I know it's been so hard, but we love you. We love you. Have them at your house. Aaron and I love you. We'd love to get to know you. And then when they leave, I bind them to the cross of Calvary. They were made by you. They're made for you. We cannot keep this gospel to ourselves. Jesus, get into their world. Jesus, touch them. Jesus, rip the veil off them. Jesus, take this Isaiah 25 covering cast that blinds them. Satan's blinding power, rip it off. My assignment, my commission, not from me, from the scriptures. Would you pray for one? For as it says in Matthew 18, whatever you bind on earth, will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Would you bind somebody to that precious love, that blood that he spilt? Would you think of someone who you can find to disciple? Because I believe a church like this has the ability where it's hard for us to find one person out of the 85 that isn't discipling someone instead of the other way around. Do you want this? Okay, I'm going to do an altar call right now. This altar call is for Christians first. If your heart has grown a little bit like mine, a bit familiar with people, forgetting eternity, not thinking the way that God thinks about people, maybe a bit busy, you know, and something covers you and kind of keeps you just where you just don't reach out like you used to, or maybe you have fear of man, or maybe you feel like you're inadequate to preach or give people Jesus. You don't have to give them a sermon. You can just pray every day like I did for my brother and just start to have coffee with them, start to get in their world. If you know though, inside you, something's gone a little bit dead, a little bit numb toward his love for the world, I want you to be honest with God and as fast as you can, run down the front here. If that is you, the Father loves you and he's going to give all of you faces and names, faces that he paid blood for. Keep coming, come all the way to the front, come in the aisles. This is beautiful. You know why? Because the Lord's going to restore to you something that happens when we first meet him, this love for others. He's going to give it back. Keep coming down. Keep coming down. We'll wait for you just a moment longer. I'm so greatly privileged and honored to speak to you, Jesus Image Church. I tell you why. Because you are such a pure church. And I know that when you say, God, yes, do this in me, I know that you will actually do it. You'll allow the Lord to move you. That's so, you don't know how much that's worth, that God can move you. Keep coming though. He's about to impart to you His love for unsaved people. And for some of you sitting here, you might weep like crazy. It might become very, very much like it did for me in my room, very, very strong and expressive by the Spirit of the Lord. I encourage you, let it grip you. It's no good if God can't grip us. Let it touch the numb parts of our soul and our heart. But I'd like to do this before I pray. I want a show of hands that if while I was speaking, God reminded you of someone or showed you a face, put your hand up. If you thought of someone, now turn around. Look at all those hands. It's everybody. God's not dangling a carrot to us. He's showing you that person because He wants to save that person. But here's what we need, Father. We need a baptism of love that goes so deep for those kneeling, for those sitting, and for those watching at home. We need a baptism of love, Father, that is beyond our human abilities. And so I pray in the authority of Jesus' name that every person here would receive right now, guys, please let go of any fear, let go of any worry about what might happen in this moment. Receive from the Holy Spirit. I pray in Jesus' mighty name, Father, that You would rip off any veil over the heart, any familiarity over the heart, any covering cast, anything that makes us dull in our love for people. Take that out of them now, and Father in heaven, pour Your love. Let them feel Your love tonight. Let them feel Your love tonight that You have for those people You showed them. Let it go in. Let them feel Your love tonight. It's okay. Some of you are weeping deeply, deeply. That's the Spirit of the Lord groaning in you. That's beautiful. Thank You, Lord. Mighty to save, our God. My Lord, give us this love. Give us this love. Let it assimilate into our daily life. Let it flow into our daily life. So much so that it becomes part of the way we do life. That we see them like He sees them. Thank You, my King. Thank You, my King. Let that love pour into you. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. And keep receiving. Just keep receiving. For those of you receiving, please do not be distracted by the sound of my voice. Let the Lord touch you. But there's a few other people in here. My life was saved and set free by Jesus almost 19 years ago. I was a criminal, small time at the time, addicted to pornography, self-hatred, filled with anger and hate to myself. I had no value for me anymore. But at 4 o'clock in the morning, I didn't meet a religion, but I heard the voice of a person. And His name is Jesus. And He didn't bring you here tonight by accident. You didn't just get brought here by somebody. You were actually brought here by God. And He sees you, friend. And you may not have been a criminal, but you can say this, that something inside me is missing. And I feel like in my strength, I can't live life. That's because sin destroys the inside of us. When Jesus said, I came to seek and save that which is lost. One of the translations for the word lost is the word destroyed. How many of you have had your life destroyed? Sin destroys us. Jesus heals us. He came out of heaven, left heaven, and He was separated for a moment from God on the cross. But God never, ever took His eyes off Him. But He was forsaken because we were forsaken in sin. On behalf of our sin, Jesus Christ died for you. And He has a plan for you, friend. And I want to encourage you, tonight you were sent here by Him. That beating in your heart, He's talking to me. That's God knocking on the door of your heart. Answer the call. because you're made to be a child of God. You're not made that your life would be a train wreck of dark emotions, of sin, of problems. You are made to be freed by Jesus, but you must humbly come to Him, receive Him as Lord, and say, you can be the Lord of my life, that I might become a child of God. He loves you enough to die for you. So with every eye closed right now, keep receiving down the front though. Please let this soak deep in your heart. With every eye closed, if there's anyone in here that you've backslidden away from God, like Aaron Adam Jedson did, you've believed, but your life is nothing like Jesus. Or maybe you never really fully believed, you knew something's out there and you wanna come closer to Him, you wanna see who He is. If you want to receive Jesus tonight and be real with Him and say, okay, I'm done. I resign myself. I invite you in, King of Glory. I want you to put your hand up if that is you. And don't be afraid. I see you, my brother. Who else is there? I see you up the back right there with your friend. He probably brought you here tonight. Beautiful. Anybody else? Anybody, I see you, sweetheart. Bless you. Jesus loves you. Anybody else? Don't be afraid. There's many hands that went up there. Thank you, my King. Yes, I see you up the very back there. God bless you. Jesus loves you. Thank you, Lord God Almighty. Anybody else? I'll ask one more time, because when God knocks on the door of your heart, you shouldn't worry about what anyone thinks of you or the opinions of people. I see you, my brother. All you need to do is say yes, because God has a plan for you. So I'll ask one more time. Is there anybody you know, I want to give my life to Jesus? Tired of playing games in sin, tired of compromise. I want to be a follower of Jesus. I want to be full of God. Put your hand up right now. I see you, my friend. God bless you, brother. Okay, here's what I want to do. I want every person that put their hand up, because as you can see, most people are literally just being touched by Jesus right now. But every person that put their hand up, I want you to do me a favor. With the friend next to you, with the person who brought you, I want you to stand up. Don't be embarrassed. He hung naked publicly on a cross for you, and He's in love with you. Stand up with the friend who brought you. Stand up. Come on, guys, give them a huge hand. Stand up if that's you. There they are. Stand up. We're going to lead you in a quick prayer. Well, we're going to leave these guys to experience what they're experiencing with God, but we're going to lead you in a quick prayer. And there's no special thing that you can say to God. God doesn't speak languages. He speaks heart. When you say it truly from here, He hears us. But He did say this, that confessing Him and believing that He is Lord of all, this is the way to salvation. Confessing that you'll turn from your sin and give Him your heart, this is the way to be free. So we'd like you to pray right now. And the Bible says, confess with your mouth from your heart and believe and you will be saved. So are you ready? Let's all pray together, church, but are you ready to pray this with me? Okay, pray this out loud. Dear Lord Jesus, I believe in who you are. I believe that you died for me and that on the third day you rose again and that you came to this earth to take my sin and destroy the power of sin, death, and the grave. Tonight, Lord Jesus, I acknowledge that I'm a sinner and I open wide my heart to you and I officially invite you to come and live in me right now. Be the Lord of my life and my best friend. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I ask you to fill me in this very moment and lead me and guide me. Now come on, church, just pray in the Spirit just for 30 seconds for them right now who are standing. Just stretch your hand toward these people. For those down here, just you keep receiving, but for those sitting, stretch your hand to them. Just pray, God, do it deeply, deep work in them. Make everything brand new. Make everything brand new. Just pray in the Spirit, because this is what I talked about before. This is the joy of salvation. All of heaven is roaring over this one who stood Thank you, my King. Father, we pray that you would bless them. Break everything off from the past. Thank you for the Spirit of God is in them now, and He will give them a new life. Thank you, great King. We bless them as a church. We bless them as a family. And we pray, Lord God, that you would use them and take them on your path. And everybody said in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Guys, look at me for a second. Yeah, come on, give the Lord a hand clap. Come on. Guys, look at me for 1 second, who is standing. I want to tell you something. Listen to this. Jesus, from His own mouth, said this. He said, in heaven, right now, He said, all of heaven is rejoicing over your life that turned to God. More than 99 saved people. In heaven right now, they are having a party because you're a Christian. You're a child of God. Come on, Jesus. Come on, church. This is the joy of salvation. Praise the Lamb of God, mighty to save. Hallelujah. Ryan has a message for you who were just born of God. Yeah. How good is that?
Amen.
You have like 900 new family members now.
That's right. Amen. Yeah, just a few things. We do this every week. Come on, how many guys, we're not dismissed yet. So for those of you guys who just said yes to Jesus, and you guys given your life, in fact, today we had our first ever new believers class. We had it right out there, and it's beautiful that you can have family that surrounds you guys. Like you guys said, you guys just got adopted into the family of God. And a few things that we love to encourage you guys in this is, number one is, read the Bible every single day. This is Holy Scripture. Bible says that man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, that this is true food. This is true life. And number two is that you talk with God. It's called prayer. It's something that we get to do every single day, that the Lord God Himself has given us full access to Him, that we could get alone and talk with the God of the universe. Number three is to be part of a local community, a family. It's what we are here today, that you can lock arms with and run this race that Jesus has set before us with family. At times, I know there's people that I can call, that I can pray with, and I could agree with, because I know they're there to speak life into me. And that's what church, this is what it's all about. And number four is to get baptized in water. We do that every so often, maybe once every month, right here. The Bible says that we are cut off from the world. Our sin nature dies in the waters of baptism because it is Him. That we get to have, enjoy, and fellowship of the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. So we want you guys, if Dion, would you stand up? This is Dion. He runs our new believers. Yeah. Amen. You guys can sign up with him, as well as those classes that we talked about. And number five is to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And just like Ben spoke of tonight, that I promise you that He empowers you to be a witness unto Him. Tonight, you guys witnessed the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And just like Ben provoked us tonight, now we can be a mouthpiece for Him. We can be His hands and His feet here on the earth. And so we're going to pray as a family together over you guys right now for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Yes. He says, just ask and He will give Himself.
Praise.
So Jesus, we together as a family,
yes, God,
we pray the fire of heaven over each and every person, God, that said yes to you today. Lord, you said ask and you will give us of yourself.
Praise you.
Father, I pray you clothe every one of them with you. God, I thank you for the baptism of fire. You're the baptizer, Jesus. We thank you, mighty King. Father, I thank you that we can be bold witnesses unto you. You said the righteous are as bold as a lion. Father, we thank you for boldness in Jesus' name, courage in Jesus' name. That only comes from you and you alone, Jesus. So we say yes and amen. God, I pray they encounter you tonight, that they encounter you as they lay their heads on the bed. I pray they encounter you in their dreams and encounter you, Father, when they wake up tomorrow morning. In your precious, beautiful name we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to step back into worship right now. Let's just look at Jesus. You guys could be where you guys are at if you want. You guys could go back to your seats. But we're going to go step right back into worship and just love on Jesus for a few minutes. So.
It's perfect. It's perfect. It's perfect.
Thank you for saving us, Jesus. Thank you for saving us, Jesus. You said those who are forgiven much love much. Let us see people the way that you see people. Let us remember how much we are forgiven and how much we are loved. Father, thank you for mercy and for grace. Thank you for your justice and truth. We love you, mighty King. Let it be said of us. Let it be said of us, Jesus. We love you, Lord. It doesn't end here. Thank you, mighty King. Thank you for everything that you have done tonight, Jesus. Every seed that was planted inside of our hearts. Let us steward those seeds. Father, we thank you. We thank you. In your precious name we pray. In your beautiful name we pray. In your majestic name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Lord. We love you guys. I know it's never an ending. Our lives are worship unto Jesus. We can stay with this heart posture right here the rest of the night, into tomorrow, and the rest of our lives. Thank you guys for watching online. We love you guys. We pray for you guys. We'll see you guys next week. Love you.